A couple of thanks for coming here. I mean, it's a pleasure to meet you. I mean, big fan of yours and stuff. So, first of all, I want to ask about brief about your career. I mean, the idea of doing this amazing writing, crime, and CSI.
Well, crime really began by accident. I always wanted to be an author. I didn't know really what to write. I wrote 3 books in my teens, which were luckily never published. And then I was in my late 20s, and I read an article. I was working in television at the time, film. I read an article, it was a shortage of spy thrillers. So I thought I could write a spy thriller, because Ian Fleming had died. And I wrote a spy thriller called Dead Letter Drop. And to my amazement, it got published. To my even bigger amazement, it didn't sell. And I was really quite despondent. And I just got married, and we got burgled. And a young detective came to take fingerprints. And he saw the book, and he said, if you ever want any research with the police, give me a call. And he was married to a detective, and my then wife and I became friendly with them. And they invited us to a barbecue at their house, and all their friends were police officers. Traffic, response, homicide. And I found them fascinating to talk to. And over the next couple of years, we became very good friends with this couple, and with quite a few police officers. And I began to realize that nobody sees more of human life in a 30-year career than a cop. You know, every kind of asset. And I remember going, once they realized I was genuinely interested, they started inviting me to come spend a day with them out of patrol. I remember doing a 12-hour shift, which at 7 o'clock in the morning, we get called to a cop death. You know, there's a young couple, and their 3-month-old baby has died during the night. Horrific tragedy. Police have to be, you know, sympathetic, but at the same time, maybe they murdered the baby. So it's a crime scene. A really difficult, you know, wire to walk along. And then an hour later, a horrendous domestic fight where a woman's just had dog feces put in her face by her boyfriend. An hour later, an elderly couple have just lost their life savings to an online fraudster. And the day goes on. And I just slowly started to realize, hey, this is fantastic material, because I think with writing, I like to write page-turning thrillers, but I try and write the kind of books I like to read, and I like to read books where I learn something about the world in which we live, about why people do what they do. And I started slowly realizing that through the eyes of a police officer is the best insight into the world in which we live. And that's how it all started. And then I was very lucky, I was introduced to a homicide detective called Dave Gaylor. We really hit it off, and I always remember going to his office, and it was just a complete tip. Crates, piles 6 foot high, full of folders. And I could just see him at the back of the room, and I said, are you moving? He said, no, these are all my dead friends. I thought, oh, great, I've met the only weirdo in Sussex CID, and he laughed, and he said, I'm a homicide detective, but I've just been tasked with reopening all the unsolved murders in the county. Each one of these crates is the principal case file. And I'm the last chance each victim has for justice. I'm the last chance each family has for closure. And I love that really human image about him. And he said, what are you writing at the moment? And I was writing a psychological thriller called Denial at the time. And he said, tell me about it. So I tell him. He said, hang on. Why hasn't your character done this? And why is your detective not doing that? And why hasn't he got an outside inquiry team? And don't you think about, this guy's got a really creative brain. We became really good friends. And in 2002, my publishers asked if I'd ever thought of creating a detective as a main character. And Dave Gaylor, at this point, had risen, who was Detective Chief Superintendent, head of Major Crime for Sussex. And I said to him, would you like to be a fictional cop? And he loved it. And he is my real life Roy Grace, and we've worked together on all 14 books so far. When I'm planning the books, we discuss it. He reads every 100 pages, tells me how Roy would really think and act as her. And that's helped to give the books that kind of authenticity I try so hard to get.
Interesting. So, there have been many issues with this book. Many issues with this book. Which one the series was the most exciting and difficult to write?
That's a good question. I guess the first one, Dead Simple, was still one of my favorites because it kind of started the whole thing. I think Dead Man's Time was quite hard because they start the book in New York in 1920, and I kind of move it through in time. But I think each book is a challenge. For me, it gets harder with every book because I want to raise the bar. I think with every book, I want to write a better book than the last one. I always think with day that I don't think that is the day I should stop. So for me, the challenge is always, the biggest challenge is moving with the times, the pace, because the books take me years to write. In a year, so much changes in policing in terms of technology. I would say the police changes more quickly than any other organization. They're always playing catch up with villains. And for me, it's fascinating to always learn about new crime fighting tools. In Need You Dead, I have something called Super Recognizers. I was introduced to them, which is really interesting because most technology, most crime fighting is high tech, you know, DNA testing, fingerprint technology. This is incredibly low tech. What happened was we had big riots in London a few years back. And the police had really difficulty in identifying the looters. They were wearing baseball caps, hoodies. Now the average human being, probably you or I, can recognize 23% of faces we've ever seen. The average police officer, with all their training, 24%. And the world's smartest facial recognition computer is about 25% right now. But they discovered there's a tiny percentage of people, maybe 5% of the population in fact, who can recognize 95% just from one facial feature, like from the shape of your nose, or lips, earlobe.
Or a scar on the face or something.
Scar, yeah, just one little detail. And they had a custody officer at Scotland Yard who correctly had this talent. And they just sat in watching videos of the rioters, and he picked out 150 who were arrested and convicted successfully. And from that, they built a squad. And in fact, they invited me up to, they wanted me to look, spend a day with them and write about it so I could spread the word to other police forces. And Scotland Yard and I have a team of about 250 people, some police officers, some civilians, some just some volunteers from the public who've got this skill, and they just sit watching videos of crimes and identify suspects.
Interesting. About the subject, you know, there's been many TV series like CSI, NCIS, about solving crime and new technology. I also watch this TV show as well. Do you get kind of references from these shows or only from old stories like Sherlock Holmes or like that?
I think in terms of my influences, it would be very dangerous to take any technologies from CSI or any other, because I think they so often take shortcuts. And you know, my accuracy comes from spending time with the police in England and America. I was out with the police in Dubai 2 days ago. I went out in a supercar, which was fantastic.
Yeah.
But I spent a lot of time out with the police because for me, research is so important. I think that everybody who reads is intelligent. And I think when we read, we don't just want a story, rattle, 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 like a kid's comic book. You know, adults, and the fact that we read means we're intelligent, means actually we want to learn stuff. You know, when I read a book, I want to learn something about the world in which we live, about human condition. And research is so important now because I think research underpins all storytelling. If you're reading a novel and you don't believe the author knows really what they're talking about, you'll lose interest.
I agree. The idea is to know about the story and to have the deep details of it, because we know we deep in the story, you know what's going on, and we engage in it. So.
Yeah, I get really immersed in it, and I'm very lucky. I have a lot of police fans, so they're all keen to make sure I get stuff right as well. And there's a big car chase scene in this, and I spent several days with the police going right over all the ground in the car chase and getting the radio right, what they'd be saying. And I think it, you know, I'm not writing a police training manual, but I think if you get some of the detail right, it just feels right.
Very interesting. I had this question, maybe kind of familiar. There's a Japanese manga series called Detective Conan or Case Closed. It's about a boy who solves crimes and like that. You heard about this series before?
I've heard about it. Yeah, I've not read about it.
Yeah, yeah. It's about a very interesting story about a boy who was being attacked by a black organization, get a drug, and then become a small kid. And then after that, he became a detective, solving crimes and stuff. And I've been there for 20 years now. So it's kind of nice to see the connection between stories about self-care in many sides of the world, from the UK, from US, from Japan. And that's what readers feel really excited about, to be in this field.
Yeah, I think what's so exciting about crime thriller genre is that it relates to people's lives. You know, if you're writing, I used to love spy thrillers, but they're people that we don't really know. Whereas when you're dealing with the police, your next door neighbour could be murdered tomorrow. What fascinates me is how ordinary so many of the world's worst villains are. You know, every time a serial killer is arrested, television crew interview the lady next door. It's always a little old lady. He was a nice man. He used to feed my cat when I was out. And you know, the worst serial killer we ever had in England was a family doctor called Harold Shipman, who just happened to like killing people and killed 350. And you know, Ted Bundy in America, you know, this charming guy, he'd been a law student, he worked for the Republican Party, just happened to like raping and killing girls and killed 103 of them. And that's what fascinates me, is who in our street or you know, who out there that we see every day is possibly not what they see.
Because the idea of this thing was do not judge people by their appearance. You need to know what their backstory, what behind the scenes. So this is a very interesting subject.
Yeah, I think that what we tend to forget is that, say, a serial killer doesn't have "I'm a serial killer" tattooed on his forehead. He's not a big ugly guy covering tattoos. He's this quite ordinary kind of person. And it's like, what makes him that? I was astonished. I do a lot of talks in prisons because it's a charity that I support, which tries to encourage prisoners to read in England. And the terrible thing is that the average reading age in an English prison, 50% of the inmates, is below 11 years old. But I was doing a talk in a women's prison, and I get the chance to meet afterwards and talk to murderers and all kinds of people. And I was doing a talk in a women's prison, and there was this very smart woman in the audience asking me good questions about books, and clearly well read. And I wonder what you're in for. And my guess was she'd maybe killed somebody, drink, bribe, or something like that.
Okay.
And I get up to her afterwards, and I never say, what have you done? I say, well, you know, how much longer do you have to go? And she said, 9.5 more bloody years, and it's just not fair. There's a woman who did exactly what I did in London, she's only got 6 more years. I said, oh, you know what? What brought you in here? I poisoned my mother-in-law, the old bag. I said, yeah? She said, well, she went to the hospital to die, so I took all the money from her bank account. The bloody woman didn't die, she came back home. I realised she'd find out, so I had to poison her. Then I realised my husband would find out, so I had to poison him too. And it's just not fair. There's a woman who did exactly what I did in London. She's only got 6 more years. I was being taken up. I said to the officer, is this for real? It's absolute, sir. My husband was 3 months on life support. He's got permanent brain damage, and she's just angry about a sentence. And I thought, you have to be a character in a future book. And I wrote her as a J.D. Bentley and Love You Dead.
Oh, that's quite shocking. Have you got a chance to with any TV station came to you and asked to think your stories on TV series?
Yes, I'm very pleased that Roy Grace is coming to television. The first book should go into production later this year. We haven't cast it yet, but it's going to be very exciting television.
So my last question is, what do you advise for people who want to be a writer?
Two pieces of key advice. The first is, which is what I did when I was a kid, was to read the books that are really successful, of the kind you want to write. So if you want to write a spy thriller or a crime thriller, read the big names. And secondly, when you found a book you really connected in that, deconstruct it. You know, if you were going to be a car mechanic, you'd start by taking the car apart, take the engine apart, see how it all comes together, put it back together. And I don't mean that in a crass way at all. I think it's I would do that with books that I love, like with Stephen King, Bright Rock, Silence of the Lambs. How did the writer make me so engaged? How did he or she keep me wanting to turn the pages? And I would literally go through a book and go through it again and try to work out how they did that.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to meet you.
You too, thank you.
And I'll talk to you soon.
Thank you very much.